welcome back. We are still in Meal of Est. We've only really talked to two people, well, not including Pajrekin up here, and then got killed by this thing. So you just finished... I know for a fact some of you could use my ciphers. We just finished looking through Lady Anche's wares. Castoff doesn't have much to say. Chalcedon. I'm aware of the defenses here, but they're not enough. You have it all figured out, don't you? I hope the shields hold. Oh, they had a lot of sight.
Job done right.
I'm aware of the defenses here, but they're not enough. Of course I do. Everyone's too worried. The portals were open before, and the Sorrow never used them. Who's to say you aren't going to leave the Sorrow here, too? Okay, let's talk to this Melmoth guy who keeps walking around. You're a little spooky looking. Your eyes are drawn to the tattered leather robes and profusion of tubes that wire this man. He kind of looks like a Borg. He is lighter skinned, with piercing eyes and a hideous pitted scar on his face. He could be handsome, but centuries of neglect have ravaged his looks. He looks you over and rasps. So you're the new cast-off, eh? Come to ask me about my Dendro or her? Or do you have some other trick you need to show off? He waves his hands irritably. Never mind. You have questions for Melmoth. What? The Feritory. What happened to me? Curiosity happened to you. He claps you hard on the shoulder. No one knows. I'd venture so far as to say it's some kind of psychic defense mechanism to keep prying noses from tampering with it. But I've gotten precisely nowhere with my investigations, so all you get from me is useless speculation. Tell me about yourself. His lopsided smile seems more like a grimace. I'm Melmoth, Levyarm. I'm the creator of the Dendroher, the greatest, or at least the most innovative, of the Brotherhoods that seek to pass along knowledge from one generation to the next. So many people back away from me because of the way I look, or the way I speak. But let me tell you that in this body I have lived countless lives, seen endless worlds, experienced memories that beggar description. I contain worlds, and they judge me for my appearance? Sometimes I wonder who I'm saving this knowledge for. What can you tell me about the Dendro or her? They call us the Eaters of the Dead. We take the knowledge from their fading flesh. Every life flickers and dies, and when knowledge disappears, the world grows darker. The rain of death washes away experience. I want to preserve. Each of the Dendro is a library of experience. A feral grin flickers on his mouth and vanishes. Every life that vanishes is a loss. Every person living has a story. The secret keys of history hide there. I want truth. I want exposure. I want knowledge to live. Death is a waste of history. We eat the dead that we might remember the lessons of time. With all your acquired knowledge, you must have a unique outlook on the endless battle.
I'll remember that.
A waste of life and criminal waste of knowledge. The weapons being discharged are lost to us forever. Each life gone is an experience that will disappear into the mists of eternity. Snuffed away, forgotten, never to be seen again. He leans in. Our sire sought to cheat death to stop that kind of waste. It is beyond my reasoning why he'd allow the endless battle to continue. What can you tell me about the other castoffs here? He leers an ugly smile. They're idiots and fools. They think their shields can protect them from the Sorrow forever. I came here to retrieve some research, and every time I come, I think of how much knowledge is in their minds and their bodies, and I wish they would just die already so I could gain access to their wasted experiences. He scratches a small infection in his hand. On the other hand, they're the closest I have to peers. Gods, what does that say about me? Let's not talk about them. They bore me. I'm looking for Mazoff. Him? That useless tinkerer? Why? I have some questions for him. Oh, a mystery. I love mysteries. I'll surmise, then. He's a machine man, a fixer of broken objects and a builder of new ones, and so you must need a repair. Or a new device. He raises a finger. But how would you have known to look for Mazoff? Who could have told you? Right, in the order of truth. What's your name? No, I don't have enough knowledge. He smirks. But I'll find it soon enough. To answer your query, I do not know where Mazoff is. I suggest asking Aadiiris. Farewell. Don't eat anything I wouldn't eat. There's a cast-off over here. Unless that's the same cast-off who walks around. I think it is. I'm not leaving until I'm sure the sorrow is quiescent again. Okay, let's talk to Andronus Sandhand. Oh, I've had enough of this. This man's face is flushed and angry, veins throb on his forehead, and his eyes are focused on his companion. Stop talking, Raima. He spits each word, gripping his weapon belt with bloodless fingers. Stop talking, or I'll prove you wrong right now. He thinks he planned this? Ridiculous. I would have known. Raima? Sorry, guys. But I wouldn't do anything of the sort, Raima replies, grinning as though she intends to eat the man whole and screaming. Even this argument is part of his plan. Do what you have to do, Andronus. If not for the law, you'd already be dead, he says, and spits at her feet. Traitor. Fool. You child, she says with laughing scorn. You ingrate. And she thinks a typical first militia response, angry indignation. This is no way for family to behave. Gold tide. They simultaneously turn silent, incredulous looks your way. What are you arguing about? Best stay out of it, Andronus says, slashing the air between him and Raima with his hand. Even a second of her boot-licking nonsense is a waste of your time. Hide from the truth all you want, Raima says, shaking her head. You know I'm right. You know it. Neither of you actually told me what you were arguing about. Of course I didn't, Raima says, grinning. Andronus never lets me get a word in edgewise. Why should I? Andronus says with a bitter laugh. All of your words are his, and I've had enough of him for a lifetime. Tell me what you're arguing about. Grinding his teeth together, Andronus merely shakes his head. Raima chuckles under her breath and runs an easy hand over her scalp. Tell me what you're arguing about. Nope, okay. How long have you two known each other, anyway? Too long, Andronus says. Raima says agreed. They still won't talk, they won't say. Nor can we get anything else out of them. Alright. Let's talk to Elkeshai. Must be hard for you being wrong all the time. This slim cast-off looks to be in his late teens. He carries an odd-looking device that resembles a scorched circle, and it's not hard to draw the connection between it and the red mark of a recent injury that travels along his forehead and under his hair. The man seems confused, hesitant, as if he has so many questions that he isn't sure which to ask first. I want to ask... I'm not sure. He gives a shaky smile. I want to ask you a lot. We all do. And he thinks about her. He thinks, about her? No. Something she did? Maybe. Yes. Who do you mean when you said we? He blinks hard at your question, twisting the blackened circlet through his hands. I once fought in the endless battle, found this in a giant clay hand. Trapped in a half-shattered block of stone, I took it. He shakes his head as if denying the memory itself. Put it on. The circlet spins through his hands, faster and faster. I saw darkness, knew I was inside the owner of that hand, a clay automaton, imprisoned, knew I could control it. He shivers. I did. Broke it free from the stone. Used it in service of our sire for many years. Thought of it as my armor. He blinks hard again, like a man trying to dislodge a thought, with his eyelids alone. Then a war construct collapsed on the automaton, crushed it, and the crown burned. I remember screaming. Then 100 voices in my head, arguing with each other, shouting, fighting. Another hard blink. The automaton wasn't armor. It was a container. A container for gods. What do you mean, a container for gods? My armor wasn't a tool. It was a locked chest with a hole inside. A deep hole full of terrible gods. He shuts his mouth and says no more on the subject. So these gods, this is the second time we heard mention of them. Rin had a god in a rock. And she said everyone in her town had a god or something in some device. And now he has this chest full of gods. I wish I could help. He nods glumly, then blinks again, and then Gold Tide raises a tiny amount. What do you think it is in your head again? Gods, he says. Many. Arguing. What was the endless battle like?
Making a note.
He shudders. We killed. We were killed. The dead crept into my mind. They told me to kill more. And I did, because that's what we do. It's in our nature, you know. We're worse than animals. Cast-offs. Humans. Whether created or evolved, we're all inclined to conflict. I don't think about it. I don't want to remember. What kind of questions did you have for me? You forced your way through our portal. It kept us safe from the sorrow. Now it's open. He swallows, eyeing you reproachfully. Carefully, you feel a stirring of voices around you. You were reckless, he blurts, avoiding your eyes. You've exposed us. Maybe killed us. I don't want to die. He's on the verge of tears. You need to tell me how bad it is, and I need the truth, he says, raising his eyes again. Have you seen it? Have you seen the sorrow? Yes. I knew it, he says, going pale. We're running out of time. Now listen, he says, blinking hard. This is even more important. Have you abused the tides to change things? To influence people? This is true, very little. He groans. It doesn't matter. It'll find you. Every use of our power draws it like a fire in the sky. Really, using the tides to change things? Attracts it. Really? You should leave, he says. But there's no heat in his words. Maybe it'll follow you and leave us alone. His trembling hand seeks the red wound at his hairline. Did you want to ask me more questions? No, I don't. He avoids your eyes. You should go. Go before it comes for all of us. Well then, farewell. Blinks. Did I look at this? The enormous tower jutting out of the ground looks like a weapon or an antenna of some kind. It makes a soft hissing noise and smells faintly of yeast. Yeast, really. Well, let's go this way then. It looks dark and cool inside this living structure. Unfortunately, the door is locked. This place is dull.
yes.
Hmm. Not sure if we can get up there. Well, there's Aadiiris. Maybe I'll talk to her last. A warm glow emanates from the windows of this house, but the windows are frosted. You cannot see inside.
Of course.
A strange burbling noise emanates from deep within this device. It looks out over the valley like a guardian.
All right.
Let's not mess with that thing again.
It is done. Let's go.
Does this one say anything different? Yeah, I've seen that one. The passageways of this structure are much too small for a human to enter. Thick flora blocks your view of what lies inside. Alright, let's look over...
Without doubt.
Henceward this way. I should... No, I shouldn't. I don't want to stay here, but I haven't been to the world for a decade. That's an interact, this one. I traveled with the first for a decade. She showed me truths I'll never forget. This building contains living quarters, presumably for castoffs who make a semi-permanent home here. The doors of the structure are locked at the moment. I'm going to come back to this machine in a second. Just want to clear out the fog of war here and see what else there may be. One would have a fantastic view of the plateau from the building on this verdant crag. This all seems extremely familiar. Okay.
As you wish.
It looks like all we have to do is talk to this... whatever name is. What if I'm wasting immortality? And interact with this thing. This is cool looking.
Of course.
This monument tapers to a narrow point. From a distance, the obelisk appears several meters tall, but when you stand at the foot of it, some kind of optical illusion makes it look as though the obelisk keeps going, rising narrower and narrower into the wide sky. Let's touch it. The moment your fingertip grazes the dagger-like stone, your mind is seized by cold fingers and hurtled high into the air. Shreds of cloud whip past, stars streak by you and are lost in the void. Ahead, a light blooms, threaded with silvery ribbons of time. You plunge into the light, and a vision of the future unfurls. Really? You see yourself asleep, bundled in blankets, snoring loud enough to tear holes in the sky. Also, you're drooling. Wonderful. The prophetic light fades, leaving you standing before the obelisk once more. You study the monument, frowning. Though the vision felt true, it hardly seemed to have been worth all that effort. Perhaps touching it again will yield different results. Now perhaps. Once more, your mind plunges into the open sky, through the grasping void beyond and into the waiting light that holds visions of the future. You see yourself staring mournfully at a half-eaten bowl of stew. It certainly looks good, but judging by your future self's expression, it was an utter disappointment. Your vision clears, leaving you before the obelisk again. The vision was just as apparently useless as the last, but perhaps this monument has more to show you. You return to the vision of the unsatisfactory meal. Your future self is poking at a stale piece of bread, into the stew, perhaps hoping to salvage the meal. Huh. Anything else? That's it, huh? So we sleep and we eat things that are not satisfying. What the hell? Are these people touching it too? I traveled with the first for a decade. She showed me truths I'll never forget. Then what good is an immortality cut short? I'm so tired of the world. Alright, let's talk to... Absolutely. What's her name over here? Aadiiris. Yeah, she's got her own thing. Lady Anch has two things. Well, she's selling... Well, because you can rest here and buy things here, that's why. Very expensive to rest there, though. So let's talk to her. Aadiiris.
I'll remember that.
Even among all your siblings in Melavest, this woman is remarkably beautiful. Clad in a robe of myriad colors, she carries herself with a distinct grace and ease. Her skin is dark brown, her hair a rippling midnight black. Her violet eyes blaze momentarily as you approach, and she holds up her hand. Her voice is musical and sweet. You are most welcome here, sister. I am Aadiiris. I am the peacekeeper of Melavest. Word of your birth and exploits has reached us here already. She smiles. News travels fast in the cast-off world, as I'm sure you've already seen. I know your desire to speak to Mazoff. I've even heard a rumor that you can alter the past, that you restored Metkina. This is strange to me, for I have two memories on the subject, one in which Metkina is whole, as we all know her now, and another in which her mind is incomplete. Perhaps my mind is the one that's incomplete. Well, actually, I changed the past, so... I guess you can't change the past, so the past her still lives on somehow, even if in just memories. I do have a mirror caster here in which Mazoff is said to appear, but he is a friend to me, as are all our family eventually, and I do not wish to expose him to danger. She shakes her head and smiles slightly. I must apologize. I do not mean to be rude, but if there is any chance it is true, I have some limited psychic ability. If you will permit me, I would examine your mind to get at the truth of these rumors about your powers. Let me ask a few questions first. Blue. Of course, you must have many. It's blue because we want knowledge first. Tell me about yourself. I keep the peace here in Melavest. Our sire brought the jagged dream to Sega's cliffs in my body. Did you know that? She shakes her head. The conflict they seek to start... I really like her outfit. The conflict they seek to start, the wars, I swore that I would make no deaths in my lifetime, bring no pain. I came here in the wake of the first's death, and her loyalists were at the throats of our sires. I brought peace to them. They agreed we would make Melavest a sanctuary again. That is my achievement, my legacy. Why would you feel guilty about our sire bringing the jagged dream to Sega's cliffs? It wasn't you. True, and yet the jagged dream knew me under a name and a history that wasn't my own. The killers, the haters, the ones who wanted to see blood and death, they would tell me of their schemes, they wanted my approval, and any action on my part, they took as such. She stares down at her hands. I have never taken a life, but blood stains me. I can't feel that again. Ever. And she thinks, he brought the jagged dream using my body. I can't be sure it wasn't me. Drink. Who put you in charge of Melavest? Why, no one did. I saw the need and forged the peace myself. I saw a path to avoid the bloodshed, and I set my feet upon it. With my end goal in mind, those who would oppose me saw that I had set my ideals that would not deviate from them. And since my plan did not involve exalting myself over them, did not put them at a disadvantage, who could say no? Indeed, I am in charge only insofar as they allow it. They are the ones who enforce the peace. I just speak of it. I do not run it. I administer. I request, I guide, but I do not take charge. I will endeavor to answer your questions. Where is Mazoff? You mean physically? That I do not know. He was captured by the Jibra of Emrah Julios several years ago, a prisoner for their menagerie, but no one knows what became of him afterward. The Mirecaster is your best hope of finding him, but I cannot let you access it until I know the true extent of your abilities. The last anyone heard of him, he was in the menagerie of Emrah Julios, but that was some time ago. No one knows what has become of him since. The Mirecaster is your best hope of finding him, but I cannot let you access it until I know the true extent of your abilities. Same, okay. What is that creepy pyramidal structure on the opposite side of the plateau? She gazes in the direction you're pointing. Ah, she says finally, the Ferritory. It's unclear whether she's saying the name with reverence or disgust. That has been here as long as anyone can remember, though not, perhaps, when Mielaves was originally founded. What is known is that the first placed it here. What is not known is why. Rumors abound, of course, but as no one knows how to activate or open it, none can be proven. What do people think the Ferritory is? Oh, the predictable legends, an escape pod of some kind, a final defense against the sorrow, should it break through, a repository of the first treasures. I heard one person suggest the first herself was still alive, preserved inside, and that she would return when we needed her most. Her smirk shows what she thinks of this last rumor. It's clear that it's a protection of some kind, but whether it's to protect us or what's inside remains to be seen. I'd like to ask some questions about, well, cast-offs, and all that entails. Of course. Oh, wow. Can you tell me about the cast-offs here? She spreads her hands in regret. Ordinarily, we see more activity here, and we would perhaps have prepared a homecoming for you, but rumor has convinced many that the sorrow has been more active of late. To ease their minds, I offered a vote to close the portals into the sanctuary. But I digress. The current guests include the Chalcedon, Lady Anch, Elkeshai, Andronus, Raima, Melmoth. I suppose you just missed my friend Paj. No, we spoke. She thinks so few join me in voting against it. I underestimated how afraid they are. They all are. Oh, so she's against closing it. The Chalcedon commands our creator's forces in the endless battle. He's a true believer, a tightly wound man, but brilliant. Lady Anch brings her trinkets from all over her mercantile empire. Poor Elkeshai has been badly treated by the world. Perhaps you could have a word or two with him. We did speak. Andronus is... Well, his best quality is that he's loyal to Paj. Perhaps I should say to the memory of the first, but he's also volatile and argumentative, and he's devoted his centuries to fighting. You'll likely find him sparring verbally with Raima, whose devotion to the ideals of our sire is the equal of his. She smiles a bit. And then my friend Melmoth, the leader of the Dendra O'Hur. Well, he's, well, quite a charmer. Speak to him. You'll see. You know, did we speak to this Elkeshai? I'm not sure. Hold on. So these two are arguing. Yes, I talked to Elkeshai. Everything's wrong, or is it all in my head? These two argue. There's Melmoth. I believe we spoke to all these people. Just want to make sure. What can you tell me about castoffs who aren't here? A small frown crosses her mouth, a minute wrinkle in her brow. Our creator chose to live a bountiful life, and he has brought hundreds into the world. He has explored many forms, shapes, and sizes, and he has led some of our kin through time-twisting loops. I do not know all their names, but I hope that I might one day befriend them, even those who have been twisted into savagery. Even if I knew them all, I would not divulge their secrets, just as I would not divulge yours. She smiles gently to take the sting from the rebuke. The best way to learn of someone is to speak to them, sister. They may snap and growl, but they will not harm you. Not here. What can you tell me about the sorrow? I know little. Nothing about where it came from, nor its purpose, nor its true desires, apart from seeing us all dead. She closes her eyes. None of us do, though some of us have devoted centuries to trying to understand it. Indeed, the creation of Milavest was intended for that purpose. But the first and the changing god grew complacent, and then they grew possessive, and then the endless battle. She sighs and opens her eyes. Sometimes I feel that the sorrow must hunt us, because so many of us are so very disagreeable. But in truth, I believe the sorrow hunts us because of something to do with the tides. Our unique powers, tied to the tides, must summon it. I have not seen the sorrow track other living beings, nor heard of it in any context but the cast-off situation. It must be the tides. It must. We know that it hunts us, though we do not know why. I believe that it hunts us because of the tidal surges, that they draw it, like flesh draws the blood feast tick. Beyond that, I cannot say. What can you tell me about Milavest? The name comes from a language predating our creator. It means Stone of Wonders. He and the first created our sanctuary jointly, sitting it on this plateau because the devices they found here prove uniquely suited to creating a sanctuary and to power the shields that protect us. They brought more of us here. Our elders hid from the sorrow, or retreated here from the cares of the world. They built homes, laboratories, and more. The shields protected them from the sorrow's gaze, but when the first and the changing god struggled, all that fell apart. The peace of Milavest was shattered, and those who remained chose sides. Blood spilled on the great disk. Factions fought for control of the wisdom gained here. She shakes her head. Such a waste. It was not until after the first death, and my arrival, that we were able to re-secure peace. And so we once again have a sanctuary for any cast-off. She looks sidelong at your companions, and their occasional guests. Would that we had not closed the doorways, though. Whether the sorrow is truly more active or not, there are undoubtedly others who would wish to find safety here. She shakes her head. I accept the responsibility for the closure. Oops. Those who chose to leave have left, and I wish the rest safety. Our home, our sanctuary, the one place we have always managed to resist the sorrow. What can you tell me about the first cast-off? She died a few years after I was born. A pity. I wish I could have spoken with her, to understand her drive and passion. She honestly thought she would serve us all, and sometimes I ask myself what she might do in a situation when two of our brothers are fighting. She shrugs, and then I remember that so many of them have died fighting in her war, and my respect vanishes. I would have loved to speak with her, help her find another way. Alas. She was driven, ambitious, and strong, and she cared deeply for all of us, but her hatred obscured the bonds between us, and she drove us into war. I'll get to this after. What do you know about the tides? I have studied them. What else can I do when I'm not trying to keep the peace here? The first and our sire used Milavest as their sanctuary, after all. Though their remaining notes are a cryptic, or piecemeal, I have learned enough to believe that it is our use of the tides that draws the sorrow to us. Each of us has access to a broader tidal power, the tidal surges, as you have no doubt discovered. But I chose not to use mine, and I have seen no sign of the sorrow. Chooses not to use hers. I recognize that this is not a logical conclusion. The sorrow might yet hunt me for reasons unknown, but I am content in knowing that I at least harm no others with my body. A smile flickers. Melmoth knows more, as he is eager to tell us at every opportunity. He has made certain to use every tool at his disposal in an effort to preserve and understand our lives, but I do not believe he has made an extensive study of the sorrow's motivations. I believe that it is our use of the tidal surges that draws the sorrow to us. When you leave Milavest, I urge you to restrain your use. Really? So there's a danger in using this too much, obviously. Let's talk about the changing god. What do you think of him? Have you seen him? Do you know where he is? That's quite a lot. That's quite a list. Which would you prefer to address first? In order. Have you seen him recently? She laughs. Never, to my knowledge. Perhaps I have, and he never revealed himself. It would be very like him to gather his intelligence and then be away. We regard every new cast-off with the suspicion that he or she might truly be our creator. And frequently, a new cast-off will pretend to be. But we find the truth, one way or another, and our sire continues to live in a way that we do not fully understand. So to be clear, you really haven't seen the changing god recently. I do not believe so, no. What do you think of our creator? A brilliant man. Thoughtful, charismatic, a mind greater than any of the Ninth World has seen. Where the Aeon priests of today cobble together bits and pieces of Numenera, our creator was a visionary. Were it not for the sorrow, I honestly believe that he would lift us into a new age of human achievement. She shrugs. He has also systematically destroyed every relationship he ever built. He does not seem to understand human frailty or emotion. No, let me rephrase that. He understands those things well enough to exploit them in others, but does not accept their reality, if you understand what I mean. More plainly, he is a selfish man who grows ever more disconnected with his inferiors every year. She purses her lips. His life is a tragedy. It truly is. He's a visionary, a genius, a man whose skills remain unsurpassed, also a deeply flawed man whose personal foibles have made him unable to connect to others, a tragic figure, truly. What do you know of his history? Much of it he has deliberately obscured, and much he has rewritten, either to make himself seem a better man or to keep his enemies from finding him, but I can provide you with the broad strokes, if you wish. She closes her eyes, recalling. He saved the city of Sagus Cliffs from the Tabat, and it was after their siege that he focused so heavily on mental transference techniques, though we do not know why. He was successful in his attempts, obviously, and this is the first record we have of the sorrow in modern times. She taps her fingers on her lips. He traveled to another world, or dimension, and I have heard that this is where the first was born. So he did all this, he saved Sagus Cliffs from the Tabat and all this stuff, before he even, you know, learned about, well, mental transference. We do not know why, obviously, to put his mind into the first. He wanted to prolong his life, obviously. His studies in the tides ran deep. He claimed to have spent lifetimes exploring them, and when he had mastered them, he destroyed the Tabat utterly. He brought the Order of Truth to Sagus Cliffs, and sought to keep knowledge alive by creating the Dendra or Her. Well, he created them, and he brought the Order of Truth. His life has been about the creation or preservation of wisdom. She shakes her head. But to what end? There seems to be no pattern or goal. He does not seem to build for humanity, but for his own legacy. Should we emulate this? You wish me to begin the recitation again? Very well. So I think this is word for word then. Okay. Instead of a different retelling. My companion Aadiiris has demons in his mind. Do you know of any healers that can help him? Her gaze moves to Aadiiris. Oddly, he is silent. Silent, sober, and looking at you. Aadiiris turns back to you. I guess it's him thinking this? We do not like this. We do not like it either. What can we do? Nothing but dig deeper and deeper. No. The only cast-off healers I know are elsewhere, tending to those who can actually be injured. My apologies. So before I let her probe my mind, let's call it an episode. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you in the next episode when we let Aadiiris probe our mind. Endure. In enduring, grow strong.
Thank you.